Greetings, dear aspirants. Welcome to today's current affairs session on Civilspedia. Today we'll be discussing about Corruption Perception Index, about Yuva Swabhiman Yojana, about Polar Vortex, and about unemployment estimation methods under our prelims topic, and regarding the case of reservation for the forward cast under our mains topic. So let's move on to our first prelims topic of the day, the Corruption Perception Index. So when you're studying about such indexes, know about that particular index, about India's rank in that particular index, and who releases that index. So we'll be seeing this topic on these lines today. So the Corruption Perception Index is being released by the Transparency International. So it is an organization working with a vision towards a corrupt-free world. So it will work in unison with the businesses, the governments, and the citizens to stop the abuse of power and the corruption in the countries. And its international secretariat is located at Berlin, Germany. So this particular index ranks around 180 countries in the world, based on the perceived levels of public sector corruptions. So there will be a survey amongst these businesses and government groups. So they will give their perception about the corruption and based on which the ranking will be done. So this score will be between 0 and 100. 0 means highly corrupt and 100 means very clean. So the maximum scores will be hovering around 88 to 90 and minimum around 10 to 15. And this particular index was first launched in the year 1990. So let's see for this particular year 2018. So the Corruption Perception Index for the year 2018 has been released in January 2019. So this report tells that more than 2/3 of the countries are scoring below 50, and the average score of countries is 43. So it tells that there is a continued failure to reduce the corruption levels across the world, leading to the failure of democracy, a crisis in the democracy around the world. And now let's move on to India's scores. So India's scores has increased a bit by 1.41 out of 100. Last year it was 40 out of 100. And rank also, it has improved 3 ranks top from 81 last year to 78 this year. So last year India was trailing behind China, and now China is trailing behind India in this particular year, because all those anti-graft charges taken by the Chinese government have failed to a larger extent, and also because of this the Belt Road initiative by the Chinese government has failed, leading to corruption, perceived levels of corruption across the governments of the world. So the Chinese rank has also failed, and also the US rank has also failed, because it is not really transparent in its way of working. The Trump's government is not really transparent. And there were some comments made on India. So this came under the Asia Pacific region. So they have told that in the year 2011, there was a mass civil organization to introduce this Lok Ayukta. So based on which the Lok Ayukta Act came in the year 2013. But Lokpal was not institutionalized at the central level by the central government in India even till now. Only in some states Lok Ayuktas has been formed. So this is one step where India has to really improve, and any further improvement cannot be seen in this particular year 2019, because it is an election year. So these two were the comments made by this Transparency International in its report on Corruption Perception Index. So let's move on to our next topic, Yuva Swabhiman Yojana. So this is a social sector scheme. When I told that when you're studying about social sector schemes, try to have these things in mind. Know about the scheme. Which state has launched that particular scheme? Who are the targeted beneficiaries in that particular scheme? So which section of people does it cater to? And what is the impact area of the particular scheme? So let's study about the scheme, Yuva Swabhiman Yojana. So Yuva is youth, and Swabhiman is Swaya Abhiman, which means self-pride or self-esteem in Hindi. So Yuva Swabhiman is basically targeting the youths towards having their own self-esteem. So that can be achieved only through means of employment and through means of skillful employment. So the government aims to achieve these both, to provide employment and to provide skill training to these youths. So this will primarily target those youths in the urban population only, because for the rural population, we have our Mandrega scheme, where 100 days employment is there. Similar to Mandrega lines, the Congress government in the state of Madhya Pradesh has introduced this Yuva Swabhiman Yojana to target all those youths to provide employment to them in the urban areas. So this is a 100 days employment scheme. So here the targeted beneficiaries are those youths from the economically weaker sections of the society. And state, as I already told, is Madhya Pradesh. So the impact area would be to cover the uncovered urban population and additional skill development training. So just try to have an idea on these lines. So let's move on to our next topic, the polar vortex in USA. So we have many of our friends in USA who are really very much discussing about this particular topic, polar vortex in USA. And there are sudden freezing temperatures that have occurred in the Midwest US and also in the eastern part of the USA. So let's try to understand what is polar vortex. So polar vortex, just take this as a globe. So polar vortex is a dense band of low pressure area in the polar region. And also a continuous jet stream can be seen. So jet stream occurs between the hot air and the cold air. And this particular area will be very dense. So this particular dense area, low pressure area, is called the polar vortex. And there are two levels, as we know. One is the troposphere and next is the stratosphere. So the polar vortex occurs in areas of the mid-level troposphere to the stratosphere area. Now there is some wave energy that will actually disrupt this stratosphere level. So because of the disruption in the wave energy, this wave energy will propagate towards the stratospheric level. So the stratospheric level will start getting warm, and because of that it will lead to disruption of this polar vortex. And this polar vortex, in normal position, it will go counterclockwise from east to west. Now because of this disruption, it will change its direction from west to east. And we also know that the jet streams will travel from west to east, and also in the north to south direction, from the poles towards the mid latitudes and equator. Now, because of this disruption, two things can happen. The jet streams will become disrupted, and or the polar vortex can split into two. So in North Pole, there are two known polar vortex. One is on the Canadian side and the other is on the Siberian side of the Russian country. It might either split or it will disrupt the jet streams. Now, what we are witnessing is the disruption of the jet streams because of this sudden stratospheric warming. So now this jet streams are disturbed. So now all those polar vortex that should occur in the Arctic Circle have descended down to the mid latitudes. So Chicago and the eastern part of the US, where New York and major cities of US are located, come in this Midwest latitude. Now they will face a very sudden chilling temperature. So it might last from days to weeks, and it will lead to hypothermia. So when you are exposed to sudden freezing temperatures, your body temperature will lower down and you might be more susceptible to frostbites, and because of that your legs or limbs might get amputated. So these are some of the implications of these polar vortex. So this I have given an explanation, and you can just have a look at this. So these are the effects: sudden freezing temperatures in the mid latitudes leading to wind chills in hypothermia. So the temperature was so worse that it was hovering between minus 50 to minus 60. So because of the sudden wind chills, the temperature in that particular area would be felt even larger than that particular temperature recorded in the monitor. And this will lead to frostbites, amputation, and it might last for days to weeks. And so it will ultimately affect the movement of the people. The entire business and the entire movement comes to a standstill. So the O'Hare International Airport in the city of Chicago was almost closed, with around 1,000 flights movements disrupted. So this is all you need to know about the polar vortex in USA. So there was also a similar polar vortex in the year 2015. And it is said that global warming is one of the reasons for the frequent polar vortices that are occurring in the US, especially in the northern part of the hemisphere. And this particular 2015 polar vortex was because of the reason that the Siberian front of the polar vortex. So the cold wind started moving from the European continent towards the eastern, towards the western side, towards the western side, which means the eastern part of the USA, finally affecting those eastern parts, the cities of New York, etc. to a larger extent, and this year it is descending down from the polar towards the Midwest latitudes. So this is all you need to know about polar vortex in USA. And you can expect a question on these lines that polar vortex occur simultaneously in northern and southern hemisphere? No, it cannot, because this polar vortex is particularly strong only in the winter, when there can be high difference, when there will be high differentiation of temperatures between the polar regions and the Midwest regions. That's why the polar vortex is very much stable in the polar region. So it cannot occur simultaneously in both the hemispheres, because when there is summer in the northern hemisphere, it will be winter in the southern hemisphere, and vice versa. So in these lines, you can expect questions on polar vortex. So let's move on to our next prelims topic, surveys for estimating the unemployment. So this particular survey was in recent news, that this survey outputs were leaked by the particular organization. So let's try to know what is that particular surveys that are being devised by the government in order to know the unemployment status in India as of now. So very traditionally, we have our 5-year survey, which is also called the quinquennial employment unemployment survey. So it is being developed by the National Sample Survey Office, and this was started in the 1950s, and it was made once in 5 years, starting 1970 to 73. So the last survey was done in the year 2011-12 only. Post that, this 5-year survey has not been conducted by the government. Now the problem with these 5-year surveys are that it takes a larger period, amount of 5 years, and plus 1 or 2 years to compile that particular data. So it takes a lot of time to know that particular unemployment data. By the time the unemployment data will become invalidated. So in order to overcome this, the government came up with this periodical labor force survey. So this was launched by this present government in April 2017. So this will replace the 5-year survey, and this will again be conducted by the National Sample Survey Office. So it will do annual survey mapping of unemployment. So in both formal and informal sectors. So what method they are going to follow is the CAPI method, or the computer assisted personal interviewing method. So this will provide a timely statistics, because it will be an annual data. And the first survey report is yet to be released. It was announced that it will be released in December 2018, but some of the data report, some of the reports, portion of the reports was leaked by some unknown people. So this is the current affairs now. And there are also some other surveys conducted by different ministries and different departments under different ministries. So let's have a look at them. Only some are relevant, and some of these surveys have been discontinued. So let's take a look at that. So some other surveys are, first one is the annual labor force survey, which is done by the Labor Bureau. It collects data only for a part of the year, and the last collected data was in the year 2015 and 16, and it was discontinued. And we have our population census, which is a once in a 10 years census. So it is basically an household census, so kind of an household survey. So this household survey is a very traditional survey, and it will give an real time data of unemployment, but it is very cumbersome when it comes to collecting from the Indian population, because our population is too huge. And we also have the labor force participation rate. It is nothing but the proportion of the labor force between the age group of 15 to 59 years out of the total workforce that is present in the country, labor force that is present in the country. So this particular report is being prepared by the Ministry of Statistics and the Program Implementation. And this was also discontinued. And the government also comes to know the amount of unemployment with the help of EPFO, your Employment Provident Fund payroll data. And it also conducts many household surveys and enterprises surveys. And when it comes to enterprises surveys, there were 5 different enterprises surveys that were conducted. So the first one is the economic census by the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. Second one is the annual survey of industries, and third survey in the organized sectors for industries and services. And we also had a quarterly employment survey by the Labor Bureau. So this was done for some time. This was again discontinued. And we also have the micro or small medium enterprises census. So these were all discontinued at some point of time. So these are some of the surveys for measuring the unemployment. Now try to have an idea about this periodic labor force survey and about the erstwhile 5-year survey. So you can expect questions in mains on these lines. So let's move on to our mains topic of the day. Case for reservation for the forward caste. So it is basically an opinion editorial. So there were three opinions. One favored this particular reservation, the other did not favor this reservation, and the third person told it's a very complicated affair. So let's see all the three opinions. The first one, who favored the reservation for these forward castes. So this particular author has spoken on the pretext of social justice. So this social justice is an evolving concept and it should be an inclusive one. So these are the points put forward by this particular author. So why it is inclusive, and when it is inclusive, there should not be any backwardness in the society. So even poverty is a measure of backwardness in the society. So when we are speaking poverty, it will also include the economic criteria of a particular individual. So we need to consider the economic criteria of that individual as well. So this was the point that was put forward by the author. And the author has also told that the preamble has promised to all citizens to give equal social, political and economic justice. So this poverty will deny the equality of opportunity in your education, employment and decent living. Hence, the author has told that reservation for this economic class is very much required, and she has justified this 10% reservation. And she has also told that this is not just limited to the upper caste, because 10% reservation in the general class. So this general class will also include those persons from the other backward classes and SC, ST, because they will also fall under the general category. So this was a statement given by the author to substantiate her claims. And she also brought in the test of constitutionality. So the most discussed case in this particular reservation was the Indra Soni case, where this particular judge put a ceiling on the reservation on socially and educationally backward category only under your Article 15 Clause 4 and 16 Clause 4 towards discrimination and employment. So this present quota has introduced this 124th Constitutional Amendment Bill. So in order to bring this Constitutional Amendment Bill, they've also amended these sections, Articles 15 and 16 of the Constitution, by introducing that the government shall work towards the advancement of the economically weaker sections. So when the government has to work towards the advancement of the economically weaker sections, it becomes quite legitimate that the government will give reservations to those people in the forward castes. So, and the author has also told the social justice is a very dynamic factor, because time it has evolved. So social justice has evolved since our independence, and it is now time to recognize those economically backward people in the forward caste, because they tend to reside in the village areas and they are not really approachable to the resources, and hence they are largely economically backward. So the author has justified in these terms that social justice is a dynamic one, and this particular government has done a right job in providing reservation to the forward caste. Now let's move on to the second opinion, that who is against this particular reservation to the forward caste. So he has also spoken on lines of social justice. This particular author has told that it is a willful subversion of social justice. So where SC has held that the social justice is a basic structure of the constitution, and this government has tend to work towards subversing this particular basic structure of the constitution. And as again, reservations are for those people who are socially and educationally backward, but not for economically backward. And when this particular clause 4 was introduced or amended in this Article 15, it discussed only about this social and economic, social and educational backwardness. It did not bring in the income criteria. So this particular author tells that, who has given the opinion, tells that it is constitutionally invalid. So this was a claim put forward by this author. And this author has also brought in some alternatives which he has suggested towards the government, and he has also pulled the government's legs. So the suggestions that he made were to bring in employment under the MGNREGA scheme. If the government really wanted to improve the the economic structure of this forward class, they could have provided employment to those forward castes under the MGNREGA scheme. Or they could have instituted new universities and colleges, and scholarship also based on their need would have been provided. Now the author has taken a dig at the government, telling that the corporate-led jobless growth has increased the income equality only. So it has increased the income equality very exponentially, thus making a little difference in the reservation to the forward cast, because already jobless growth is prevailing and there is no point in giving reservation to this forward cast. And also the public spending towards the scholarships have almost come towards an halt, was the claim made by the author. And the author has also told that the government has cut away another slice of the already shrinking pie of the public sector institutions. This is nothing but he refers to the reservations in the public sector institutions. So there is already a 49% cap, plus now a 10% cap on forward cast will be around 59%. So slowly, slowly, this pie is shrinking. This is what the author means to tell. And he has also taken a dig at the government, telling that demonetization and poor implementation of GST was one of the worst performers of this present government. And this 10% reservation is nothing but a fig leaf, like a small leaf to cover all the failures of this present government. So this author has completely taken a dig at the government by not giving a valid fact why that there should not be reservation to the forward caste. Now we have our third author who has given a really valid facts and has told that it is a very complicated one. So he has spoken about this Constitutional Amendment Act. So when it comes to Constitutional Amendment Acts, some Constitutional Amendment Acts requires ratification of 50% of the state legislative assembly that is present in the country. So under Article 368, we have the Constitutional Amendment Act, wherein a bill can be introduced in either of the houses of the parliament. And this bill can be passed by a majority of the total membership of that house present and voting. And this will again go to the presidential assent. Once the president gives assent, the bill is declared to be passed and the amendment is made to the Constitution of India. Now, there are some articles which will fall under this ratification category. So if you see all these articles and chapters that deals the role of states in the Constitution of India. So this is with regarding to election of president, Article 54 and 55. And here Article 73 and Chapter 5 of 6 deals with the legislative powers of the state governments to enact laws in the particular state. So this power has been given by the center to the states under the Constitution. And we also have this union list, state list, concurrent list, which are discussed under this part 9 and the state list. So this 7th schedule exclusively deals with the state list. And if you see chapter 4 of part 5 deals with the Indian judiciary, the union judiciary, where the state governments also have a role. So only under these articles can the ratification be possible. So this was the facts that has been given by the author. And he has discussed in large about the evolution of Article 15 of the Indian Constitution. So Article 15 of the Indian Constitution mainly aims to prohibit the discrimination on any grounds. So this is a fundamental right of every citizen who is residing in the country of India. So this clause 1 and 2 of Article 15 states that the state shall not discriminate against any citizens on grounds of race, caste, sex and place of birth or any of them. And Article 15 section clause 3 onwards gives policies towards protective discrimination, like protecting the welfare of this particularly weaker sections of the society by giving in reservations. So the policy of granting special privileges to underprivileged sections. So here the privileges means the reservations. So the foundation of reservations in education and employment is based on these clauses only. And now the 93rd Constitutional Amendment Act came into being in the year 2005. So it aimed for giving reservation to the OBC category, and the 27% OBC category reservation came into being. So in matters of employment and also in matters of education in government institutions as well as the private institutions. So after this, the OBCs started having reservations in all the prominent institutions, the premier institutions of the country like IIT, IIM was a claim made by the author. So this was challenged in SC, the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court upheld this particular amendment to the Article 15. But it also told that it is not applicable to the creamy layer. Creamy layer are those persons in the backward classes whose economic background is slightly stronger. And it upheld this particular validity of this 93rd Constitutional Amendment Act. So this judgment also told that this amendment does not violate the basic structure of the Constitution, which is nothing but the social justice that was discussed by the previous two authors. And yes, discussed about this particular 9-judge Supreme Court ruling. So just try to have these points in mind. It will be helpful for your mains to just write it as a quote. That judgment has told that reservation is a remedy for historical discrimination and continuing ill effects. So historically, even before independence, there was caste discrimination in India. In order to overcome this, the reservation has come. And the second point tells that the reservation is not aimed at economic upliftment or poverty alleviation. So it basically aims to uplift the social status of the individual, not the economic status of the individual. So this economic weakness is on account of social backwardness. So when a person is socially backward, so he is also economically weak. So economically weak cannot be a separate criteria. It comes under the social backwardness criteria. So if you are introducing an economic criteria as a valid point, then it will virtually delete this Article 16.4 of the Constitution, nothing but providing employment or to all these socially backward sectors. This was a point claim. This was a claim made by this particular author, and he has also discussed about this particular criteria that was brought under this Constitutional Amendment Act. So, for providing reservation to these forward caste people, the eligibility criteria is they should be earning less than 8 lakhs per annum, and they should own less than 5 acres of land. So those people who earn less than 8 lakhs per annum and who own less than 5 acres of land are eligible for reservation. Now, if you split this 8 lakhs per annum, per month, it will be around 66,000 approximately. So which means, does it mean that a person earning 66,000 a month is economically backward? So this was the question put forward by the author. And yes, also questioned that, is this the new poverty line for India? So we have our tax-paying people who are under the slab of 2.5 lakh to 5 lakh. So 2.5 lakh divided by 12 months is your 25,000. So even a person earning 25,000 per month is paying tax. But you are giving reservations to persons who are approximately earning 66,000 per month. So is this justifiable? Is what the claim made by the author. So the author has stressed that reservation is not an anti-poverty program. So this was the claim made by the third author, and he has told that it is quite a complicated affair, and a larger amount of debate is necessary to adjudicate this and validate this reservation for the forward caste. With this, we are winding up our today's topic. Please do like, comment and share the video, and please subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.